What's up, weebs and waifus? So, you think you know Death Note? It's kind of a complicated show with a lot of little details and interconnected plot threads, so you'd be forgiven for having missed a thing or two. But what if I told you that everything you know about the entire ending of the show is wrong? Well, first you'd probably look at me like I'm crazy, but bear with me. To be clear, I'm not saying you made a mistake here, I'm saying Death Note did. Or rather, the author of Death Note, Tsugumi Oba, did. Based on everything in the story up to that point, all the rules that were established, the plot line set in motion, the abilities, limitations, and personalities of all the characters, the ending couldn't have happened as depicted. The show itself shows us multiple examples of how that ending would be impossible. Let's make like a Shinigami and take a big chunk out of the end of this anime's life. Oh, and in case your detective skills are a bit rusty, spoilers ahead for the plot and ending of Death Note. First, a quick refresher in case it's been a while since you've seen the show. Skip to this timestamp if you don't want to hear the recap. One day, a genius Japanese high school student named Light Yagami finds a supernatural notebook that can cause the death of anyone whose name is written in it. Light decides to use this power to make the world a better place by punishing criminals and those he deems evil. Soon, the public realizes that there must be some kind of serial killer behind all these deaths, and dubbed the mysterious murderer Kira. The case then catches the attention of the world's greatest detective, a reclusive genius known only as L. L and Light engage in a battle of wits, playing 5D speed chess in order to discern the other's true identity. Light eventually manages to kill L and assume his identity, with everyone else in the world thinking the original L is still alive. In the years that follow, all the world's governments submit to the will of Kira, with many people even worshipping him as a god. It seems like Light is one. The only people still trying to catch Kira is the Kira Task Force, which Light himself is in charge of. And all the world's other crime-fighting organizations and governments have stopped chasing him and most officially endorse and support him. But then, we're introduced to two new characters, Mellow and Near, two genius prodigy orphans who were being raised with the intent of one of them becoming L's successor. Mellow ends up taking over the Mafia and attempts to take the Death Note for himself, but he ends up dying. Near, on the other hand, goes to America, gets a meeting with a president, and gets official backing for a new anti-Kira organization, the Special Provision for Kira, or SPK. This all comes to a climax in the final episode of the series, where the SPK, led by Near, and the Kira Task Force, being led by Light, posing as L, meet up in a warehouse and wait for Teru Mikami, a devout worshipper of Kira to whom Light had previously given a Death Note, to show up and write everyone's names. This happens on the 28th. Near is betting his and everyone else's lives that the Death Note won't work, because the SPK had secretly replaced Mikami's Death Note with a fake. If Near is right, they'll be able to take the notebook from Mikami, and if the names of everyone other than Light are written down, that proves Light is Kira. Light is confident that the Death Note will work, and that everyone but him will die, because the notebook that Mikami had been using before then was already a fake, and the real one was locked in Mikami's safe deposit box at the bank. So Light believes that the SPK will have replaced the pages in the fake notebook, and Mikami will be using the real one that he retrieved from the bank on his way to the warehouse. Well, it turns out that Mikami went to the bank to use the real notebook just one other time, on January 26th. And when he did, the SPK got suspicious. We're told that they checked out what's in Mikami's safe deposit box using copies of his keys that they'd made, and found the real notebook. Then, in the span of a single night, they managed to break into the bank, steal the notebook, create a perfect fake copy, and place it in the safe deposit box. So, when Mikami stops at the bank to pick up the real notebook on his way to the warehouse to write down everyone's names, it turns out that what he's picked up was another fake. Now, does anyone see the problem with this yet? Well, if not, I'll tell you. It would have been impossible for the SPK to pull off the switch the way the story tells us that they did. Are we honestly expected to believe that Giovanni, all by himself, was able to break into the building, and break into the vault, and get into the safe deposit box, and get out with a notebook, and create a perfect forgery, and put the fake notebook back, and then lock everything back up exactly the way it was and get out without anyone noticing or leaving any evidence that they'd been there at all? Nonsense! How did they disable the alarm without leaving any trace it had been disabled? What did they do about the security personnel at the bank? How did they physically gain access to the building? Did they break a window? Pick a lock? Cut a hole in a wall? Anything they did would leave physical evidence that they wouldn't be able to cover up in one night. So how did they manage to make sure the bank was actually open the next day when Mikami showed up, rather than being closed due to being a crime scene? Heck, forget about getting access to the building. How'd they get access to the vault? We're talking about a bank vault. Those things tend to be made of reinforced steel that's several inches thick. You'd need a giant oxyacetylene cutting torch and an entire day to get through one. And even if you did, I'm pretty sure the bank employees would notice the giant hole melted in the door and they'd call the police. But hey, let's say they found a way around all that and did manage to get in and steal the notebook through, I don't know, fairy dust magic. They still would have to create a perfect copy of the entire Death Note in just one night. Let me make it clear just how crazy that is. We're told that Megumi fills in one page of the Death Note per day. That may not seem huge, but he crams in 456 names per page! In one scene, we see a shot of a filled-in page, and it's got six rows of names going all the way down the page, with what looks like 76 lines per row. Megumi was actively using the Death Note for 2 months, from November 27th to January 26th. So at 456 names per day times 61 days, that works out to 27,816 names. They expect us to believe that one man copied 27,000 names in one night? That is mathematically impossible. Average writing speed is approximately 13 words per minute, while even the fastest writers top out at around 30 words per minute. Even if we assume Giovanni is only writing first and last names 27,000 times each, and ignoring middle names, it would still take over 30 hours even if he was in the top 1% of fastest writers. Not to mention that 30 words per minute is assuming he's writing as fast as he possibly can, and not going slow and careful to make sure every character is copied perfectly. I mean, we see Megumi look at the notebook under a microscope to check if it's been tampered with. If Giovanni was speed writing like this, there's no way he'd be able to copy things so perfectly that a microscope can't tell the difference, so he had to be writing significantly slower. Let's say one-third of that speed, so 10 words per minute, and that's being generous. At that rate, it would take over 92 hours. That's nearly 4 days! And we're told he did this in one night. Impossible, I tell you! That's also all assuming he's just writing nonstop, not copying. In reality, he'd have to stop after every name to read the next one before writing it down. In fact, he'd have to carefully study each and every line, dot, and stroke to make sure he copied them perfectly. That's gonna increase the amount of time it takes substantially. And on top of that, he has to write all these names in Japanese, while his native language is English. Even if we assume he knows how to read and write Japanese, he's definitely gonna be slower at it than writing in English. That's also assuming he just writes nonstop without ever taking a break to eat or drink or go to the bathroom or because his hand is cramping up like crazy. And even without all of that, 30 hours is already longer than they had. They broke into the bank on the night of the 27th and met with the Kira Task Force on the 28th at 1 p.m. And we know they had to get the fake notebook back into the deposit box before the bank opened. Even if we assume the bank opens late, let's say 10 a.m., and it closes super early the day before, let's say 4 p.m., that still only leaves 18 hours. The break-in itself would take some amount of time, plus driving back to their base to make a copy, then driving back to the bank again, so at most they would have had 16 hours to do the actual copying, and that's being generous. Oh, and this is also all not counting the hundreds of thousands of names that Light wrote into the notebook before giving it to Megumi over the half a decade Light was active. So yeah, the idea that the SPK could break into a bank, get into the vault, get out with a notebook, copy over 27,000 names perfectly in Japanese, go back, plant the fake notebook, then lock everything up without leaving any signs of a break-in, all in a single night? It's laughable, really. So if switching the notebooks was impossible, then when Megumi shows up at the warehouse, he would have been using the real notebook, and Nier and the SPK and everyone but Light would have died, and Light would have won. So then that leaves the question, what is the real ending of Death Note? Well, the part where L dies. If you've watched or read the series, it's abundantly clear that the tone, pacing, and quality of the story drop drastically past this point, not to mention that the manga, which was normally a weekly release, took a 2-month hiatus after release of this chapter before resuming. It's most likely that Sugumi Obo was pressured by Shonen Jump into continuing the story past its intended ending. In fact, Shonen Jump is sort of infamous for this sort of thing. They did it with Dragon Ball Z, which was supposed to end after Frieza. They did it with Bleach, which was supposed to end after Aizen's defeat. And Sugumi Oba's next work after Death Note, Bakuman, is the story of a manga author trying to make it big, and at one point, the main character is shown drawing a manga which is clearly a parody of Death Note, and being pressured by his editors to keep the story going past its intended end. So all in all, I think it's pretty clear that Oba wanted to end the story with L dying and Light winning, but Shonen Jump made him keep going. And given that the final ending that we see is pretty much impossible from every angle, I think it's fair to call Chapter 58/Episode 25 the real ending, and the ending we see in Episode 37/Chapter 108 is more editorial interference. Regardless of whether you think the episode 37 ending counts or not, I think we can all agree the episode 25 ending is much better. Hey, thanks for watching. If you liked what you saw, please consider subscribing and hitting the bell to make sure you catch my next video. Want more like this? Check out my previous videos on the real and fake Legend of Zelda timelines. This has been So You Think You Know, and now you do know.